الرحمن الرحيم Dear students, Assalamu alaikum. Today, first I will discuss remaining part of the previous lecture, which was about three important rules of dangerous drug Act 1930. But before that, I have told you about WHO criteria of addiction, brief history and background of this law. Coming to today's agenda, I will talk about two things. First, remaining portion of Dangerous Drug Act 1930. Number two, take up new and important themes of general toxicology. So first is Dangerous Drug Act. In this, I am going to describe strategic measures taken by government to prevent abuse of dangerous drugs. Then amendments were made in these rules. And what are three important rules of this act? That is rule number 8, rule number 13 and rule number 14. These are essential rules. So, in Dangerous Drug Act 1930, what are strategic measures? They are number 1, punishing severely to those criminals who indulge in illegal transport of drugs. And number 2 is restricting availability to those who are predisposed to their abuse. That means no open sale and purchase of dangerous drug is allowed. Now, what amendments were made in this law? That was done in 1958, because this thing was not being controlled properly, so government imposed severe punishments like death penalty, confiscation of property of those people who indulge in contraband traffic, and addiction treatment centers were to be established in the psychiatric wards of the government teaching hospitals for drug addicts. So after that, I take up dangerous drug rule number 8, then 13 and then 14. Now, in dangerous drug rule number 8, it deals with modes of sale and supply of the drugs, dangerous drugs, which are highly restricted and only on doctor's prescription. So this sale and supply is only on doctor's prescription, and it is also very limited in a small quantity and is restricted. This rules comes under second strategic measure mentioned above. According to this rule, government issues license to a practitioner, to a particular chemist, who is authorized to store and sell these drugs either to medical practitioner or directly to patient having prescription of authorized medical practitioner. First, I will describe how he sells drugs to medical practitioner which is known to him. The conditions to be fulfilled for sale are: number 1, MP or medical practitioner will personally sign the register in person. That means he has come to take the drug to the chemist, and in the inventory register he will himself sign. If he doesn't come himself, then he will send a written signed order stating his name, registration number, address, name of prescribed drug and its quantity. This was first condition. Number two, licensee shall satisfy himself. He will make sure that signature and qualification of doctor or medical practitioner are genuine. Number three, in case if drug is to be sent by post, then it will be a registered post. Number four, in case of emergency, the drug can be sent on oral message of the practitioner. So these were four conditions for selling drug to a medical practitioner. Next is how the drug is given to any person or patient who himself comes to the chemist and gets it directly from him. So there are conditions, following conditions have to be fulfilled before giving the drug to MP, to the patient, sorry. Number one condition, the drug will be sold in a quantity as mentioned on prescription. The prescription will be valid for one time only, as it will be retained by the chemist after the patient receives the drug. So that means the chemist will take the prescription from the patient and it won't be used again. Number three, another type of prescription is called superscription, which is valid for several times, but maximum limit is 6 times. Chemist while selling will make entry in registers, sign, seal and return the prescription to patient to be used it next time. So this superscription will be given to the patient, but maximum it will be given, it will be used for 6 times. And when this limit has exceeded, the chemist will not sell this drug to, so it will become invalid. Next is dangerous drug rule number 13. It deals with limitations about quantity of drugs which a medical practitioner can keep at a time. Number one, medicinal hemp. This is also other name for cannabis indica. So a medical practitioner at a time can have only small quantity of these drugs like cannabis or hemp, 3 ounces, which is very small quantity. Medicinal opium, 3 ounces. Number three, opium alkaloid and prepared from opium. So these things, opium alkaloid derivatives prepared from opium, so 60 grains he can keep. And number four, coca derivatives, that is cocaine, only 60 grains. So you can see these quantities are very small. So that was about drug rule number 13. Next is dangerous drug rule number 14. It deals about maintenance of record, which is very important part of it. The entry of record is done in separate registers for each drug or in separate parts of same register for each of the following classes of drug and preparations, so which are cocaine and preparations, medicinal opium, morphine and preparations, morphine derivatives and preparations, and extracts or tinctures of Indian hemp or cannabis. Now number 6 is how chemist will make entries in register. So he will make entries with date on a day when he receives the drug and when he gives it to some patient. If there is more than one premise of chemist, that means he has more than one outlets, then a separate account of drugs for each outlet he will maintain. Each entry of sale and purchase of drug should be in ink, that means by pen or ball pen, and no cancellation or obliteration or alteration can be done. So, but in case of any mistake, then the correction should be made by footnote with due date. So at the bottom of the page, he can write the correction, but he will not change the original mistake. Now next is inspection of record in possession of medical practitioner. Now when a medical practitioner inspection is done by any officer or district health officer, DHO or EDHO or whatever it is called now, or inspector, he will be above inspector, not below inspector. So medical practitioner has to submit information on demand made by the examiner, that is either EDHO or any inspector. Now all records should be retained for 2 years from date of last entry. So he can't say that old record is not available on asking by inspector. That was about inspection of record, and next is safety of drugs. So drug should be kept under lock and key, and when ordered by a chemist or some patient, full precautions should be taken while carrying it, and any report of theft or loss should be informed to police. So that was all about Dangerous Drug Act, and go through today's points, and previous lecture contains more material about it. Next topic, second topic today is revisit or some important themes of general toxicology. This general toxicology is part of toxicology, and this has been taught to you in the beginning of the session. I think whole of the class was present still to take up few important topics. It is necessary to inform you that it contains one SCQ and 5 MCQs in TOS, and source is for general toxicology Parikh's textbook of medical jurisprudence and toxicology, section 8, page 507 to 694. Now this book is for whole toxicology, and then you can the first chapter of this book will be about general toxicology, so that chapter is very important for you. So before taking up any topic, I think it's better to mention or to point out some definitions important definitions like what is toxicology. It is from Greek word toxikon, which means a poisonous substance applied to arrowheads. This is science or study of poisons. Another definition is it is the science which deals with poisons with reference to their sources, properties, mode of action, symptoms and signs they produce, fatal dose, fatal period, nature of fatal results, treatment, methods of their detection and estimation, and autopsy findings. It is also concerned with law regarding their sale and prescription. So I think this definition is now very clear to you at the end of the session, because you have read special toxicology, and in those individual poisons you have come across all these headings. What is poison? A substance which, when administered, inhaled, applied or ingested in relatively small amounts, may cause harm to human body. And what is toxinology? It is science which deals with toxins produced by plants, animals, bacteria and fungi, which are harmful to man. And what is toxicity? The quality of being poisonous. What is toxic substance? Any substance which contains poison, that is any drug or any chemical, will be a toxic substance. What is chemical injury? Destruction or alteration in cellular or organic structure and function produced by non-biologic substance. Any substance causing injury to human life by chemical reaction produces a chemical injury. Now, what is poisoning? This is very important, and an SCQ or question has been asked in prof something about poisoning. So poisoning is use of poison to cause harm. So it deals with application of poison or giving of poison to someone, or taking by himself, someone by himself. This is a clinical condition because it produces effects, signs, symptoms, and it has legal implications, because the person who is using this poison may have some intention to kill someone, to harm someone, or to harm or kill himself. It's based on this poisoning can be divided or classified based on duration and species. So types of poison. If it is based on duration, it will be acute, chronic and subacute. What is acute poisoning? Single large dose or several small doses taken in short period with abrupt sudden onset, that is called acute poisoning. And what is chronic poisoning? Small doses taken over a long period with insidious, that means gradual onset which is harmful. Subacute poisoning it lies in between acute and chronic. The acute poisoning sometimes becomes subacute. Now, based on species, the poisoning can be human or animal. Human poisoning is based on circumstances divided into four types: suicidal, homicidal, stupefying and accidental poisoning. Number one, suicidal poisoning. Now this question about suicidal poison of choice or ideal suicidal poison has been asked. Now it is use of poison to cause harm or kill himself or herself by someone. Important suicidal poisons are potassium cyanide, hydrocyanic acid, opium, barbiturates, organophosphorus compounds. Now you will see this opium and barbiturates may be very popular suicidal poisons because they affect depressed brain and they cause coma, so they are almost painless. Organophosphorus is not painless, but it's easily available, especially in rural areas where they are used for spraying the fields. So that is why there are many cases of suicide by organophosphorus compounds. Now, what should be qualities of a suicidal poison which is effective and ideal for suicide? It must be cheap, so everybody can buy. It should be easily available, as I told you, organophosphorus compounds are easily available. It may be given in any food or drink, so easy to use, pleasant taste and no repulsive smell. Fatal dose should be small, so that suicidal want to die quickly. Fatal period should be short and painless. So these are some of qualities of a ideal suicidal poison. Now coming to homicidal poisoning, number two is homicidal poisoning. This is use of poison to harm or kill others. Examples are arsenic, aconite, thallium and strychnine. So what are qualities of an ideal homicidal poison? So again, this is a question has been asked. It should also be cheap and easily available. It should be colorless, odorless and tasteless. Now here these points are very important: colorless, odorless and tasteless, because the victim shouldn't know that he is using poison in any case. So if there is no smell, if there is no taste and if there is no color or it is white, it can be easily mixed in a food or drug or something, drink, which the patient or victim won't be able to know. So it is given in any food, drink or drug without arising suspicion. Now the symptoms resemble with disease. So when a victim takes it unknowingly, given by someone, then he gets sick, maybe gets diarrhea like in arsenic. So then there is no suspicion of poisoning. Fatal dose is small. Fatal period is sufficiently long. Why? To permit poisoner to escape without arising suspicion. So it will take some time, it will be slow to kill. In that time the poisoner or the criminal can escape. No antidote available, no detection at autopsy or by lab. So some poisons or drugs are not detected in body on autopsy, and they are not detected by chemical analysis, and sometimes their treatment is difficult, so that is why they become popular with criminals. That was about homicidal poisoning. Next is stupefying poisoning. Stupor means lower level of consciousness. The person may be semi-conscious but is unable to decide or think anything. Giving poisons to stupefy others for committing crimes such as robbery, kidnap, rape, etc. Examples are alcohol, cannabis indica, opium, dhatura. Now this cannabis indica, opium and dhatura, three poisons are also named as roadside poisons. And cigarettes containing arsenic, dhatura are cannabis. Now number four, what are accidental poisoning? What is accidental poisoning? Now everybody knows accident is by chance, by some mistake, but there is no intention of causing harm or getting harm. So what are causes of accidental poisoning? Number one, carelessness in storing poisons and non-poisons together. Sometimes people at home, they store all dangerous and healthy things together, and that is not proper way. By mistake anyone can take it, especially children. Number two, quack remedies. Now quacks are unqualified people who practice medicine, and they are not well aware of side effects and many other things about medication, so they can prescribe in large doses, and patients can also overuse, and so that can result in poisoning. Like arsenic is very favorite of quacks. Now bites by poisonous animals like snake bite, etc. This is accidental poisoning. Number four, greater use of chemicals, processed and chemicals in different forms can lead to accidental poisoning. Number five, putting poisonous substances in food containers. This is very dangerous. When in empty food bottles which contains food and they are empty, food is no more, it is used. Now these bottles are used to store some chemicals, some poisonous material in them. Now which anyone can mistake and take it and get poisoning. For example, in the empty bottle of Coke or 7-Up, if someone puts kerosene oil, it will also transparent liquid and it will cause severe poisoning. Next, after poisoning, very important SEQ can come in exam, branches of toxicology. Now toxicology is divided into five branches, that is forensic toxicology, clinical toxicology, environmental toxicology, occupational toxicology, and veterinary toxicology. Now what is forensic toxicology? It is the branch of toxicology which deals with medico-legal aspects of toxic effects of drugs and chemicals or poisons. After studying special toxicology, now you all know what are medico-legal aspects. They are concerned with intent of accused. So accused, they possess these give these poisons with mere intention to kill someone, or especially homicidal or suicidal poisoning is the more relevant in medico-legal aspects. Accidental poisoning may be a different story. So chemical analysis and properties of poison known to experts are helpful in forensic toxicology. it is given, it gives a cause-effect relationship between exposure to drugs, poisons and its harmful effects. As the victim or patient comes with signs and symptoms which are harmful effects, the medical examiner treats him and also relates those effects to a particular poison, which becomes cause of poisoning. Based on his knowledge, experience and chemical analysis reports, in many cases he is successful to determine cause, and if it is due to a foul play, then the police investigates and reaches to the culprit and brings him to the court for trial. So to confirm the allegation of poisoning on an accused, there are highly sensitive analytical methods to detect toxic compounds or poisons in biological fluids and tissues such as blood, urine, vomitus, stools and viscera collected in dead bodies due to poisoning. So these are the various aspects of forensic toxicology. Next is clinical toxicology. It deals with specific diseases caused by toxic substances, and it also includes their treatment. So it includes chemicals, study of chemicals originating from all sources. So they may be from any source, those chemicals may be from anything, they are included. It is concerned with all aspects of interaction between chemicals and people. That means what is the route of administration of poisons, how it is ingested or swallowed or inhaled or injected or applied on skin. So in this way, that means the source, what is the source of poisoning and how it is reaching to the victim. Next is environmental toxicology. This is a broad discipline of toxicology, includes the study of chemicals that are contaminants of food, water, soil or atmosphere. Examples are from food, there are food additives and chemicals added to food. Air pollutants, in air you find pollution, carbon monoxide gas, you may find other gases and hydrocarbons. So these are industrial waste and automobile gases coming from industry and automobiles, etc. Water pollutants are waterborne viruses and bacteria, sewage and industrial pollutants. So these are industrial waste is also thrown in water, in rivers, in canals, and also human excreta and many other waste is thrown in water. So water can be full of these viruses and bacteria. Number 4 branch is occupational toxicology. It is also called industrial toxicology. Now after industrial revolution in whole world, in every country, there are thousands of industrial units like factories, workshops, refineries, mills, etc. And millions and billions of people are working there. So a new type or branch of toxicology is there, that is there are chemicals or raw material or other substances which are used there. Most are dangerous chemicals and those workers they inhale, come across, interact, and they can get very sick, they can be poisoned. So this that is why this occupational toxicology is also called industrial toxicology. It is not limited to industries only, other occupations like hospitals, labs and other places are also getting lot of poisoning. So it is created to protect worker from poisonous substances and to make his working environment safe. Objective of this is to prevent impairment of health of worker while on job. So the objective of industrial or occupational toxicology is that the worker, those who are exposed to too much danger of poisoning, it should be minimized and they should not get sick. Now there is a post of industrial toxicologist posted in industries. He defines permissible or safe levels of exposure to chemicals like dust, fumes and other particles. Also he determines the timing of the workers, how much duration he should work, what is, and also periodic health examination of those workers is done, and those who are found suffering by poisoning, they are given rest and off and treated accordingly. Number 5 branch, 5th branch is veterinary toxicology. This is study of specific diseases by poisons in animals. So with that, I conclude today's lecture. Thank you very much.